were you able to get that brochure that the Commission on Disabilities on First Help?
This is our overall brochure. So I have that for you. I have one for each, for your councils, and then if you need more, I'll send directly.
Because I need it for Commission on Disability.
Okay.
Okay, I'll send.
Not quite.
Just let me know.
Sorry.
Nope, not a problem. You had to do our mechanics over there. You had a lease. Good. Good.
Let's make sure that gets on the tape.
You kept starting to look like that picture over there.
When I was a baby. Well, I'm not in meetings all night and all day anymore. Makes a difference.
It does, it's a different life. Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
I'm gonna wait till she gets.
Do you have somebody else coming in too?
Pardon?
Do you have somebody else coming in too?
Yeah, 5 o'clock. Steve Connors was going to be here, but because I screwed up on the date on that Monday versus Wednesday, Rebecca's coming in and giving her financial word.
School vacation week, it's kind of hard to pin people down too.
It is.
It's been a very quiet week at work.
And it's getting all these agencies.
Yeah.
You know, we're looking for new ones, and especially in the arts and stuff, it's become.
Yeah.
Might as well start, I don't.
You can't get it connected?
Find it, no, it's connected, it's just my own misorganization.
I would like to open up the meeting on social services, veterans, culture and recreation. And members present is, to my left is City Councilor Alyssa Klein from Ward 7, and I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge. And I'm calling this meeting to order. I would also like to announce the video audio taping that's occurring at this meeting. And I would also like to do an approval of the minutes of March 16th.
Move to approve the minutes?
Second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Public comment, I don't see any public here. And I would like again to thank Claire Higgins, the Executive Director from Community Action of the Franklin, Hampshire, and North Quabbin Regions. And Claire, welcome again, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Well, thank you for inviting me, and thank you on behalf of Community Action.
You're welcome.
For inviting me. These are, this is our last year's annual report and a brochure that we have, which has our program information on it. I have enough here for the rest of the council too, and here's the brochures. You can share those with the council or keep those for the Committee on Disabilities.
Thank you very much.
And I'm gonna keep one of these just for my talking, and then I'm gonna give it back to you.
Okay, Claire, so I know that you're going to be giving an overview of your programs and the statistics for Northampton. And also, she has brought us some flyers, and there's excellent information about the programming and Community Action. And if you also look at the 2014, which is their annual report, it's an excellent, excellent booklet. Thank you, Mary Claire, for coming today.
So let me apologize in advance. We were trying to pull out statistics from last year from our database, and we ran into a glitch today. So I'm gonna email you our statistics for Northampton.
Great.
Okay, we have a new database, and we're still trying to learn all of the ways you manage the reporting, and the guy who does the reporting was actually training people in the database, so.
Okay.
I will get your information, but let me just talk briefly about Community Action. So Community Action is the agency chartered by the federal government to work with people to provide economic opportunity. So we try to meet people where they are and help them move forward in their life. The agency was founded in 1965. That was the beginning of the Community Action agencies being authorized by the Congress. For this organization, Community Action, it grew out of Franklin Community Action Commission. Set of government leaders in Franklin County chose to ask for a Community Action agency for the whole county. Concurrently, one was set up in Hampshire County known as HCAC. when HCAC, about 10 years ago, lost its charter as a community action agency, Franklin County picked up the community action designation for Hampshire County too. So now we cover the 1,400 plus miles for Hampshire and Franklin County. In addition, we offer Head Start services for Western Hampden County. That is Agawam, West Springfield, and Westfield. So we cover about 1,700 plus miles altogether for all of our services. We employ about 300 plus employees spread across that entire region. The largest program that we run is Head Start in terms of employment. In Northampton, we run a Head Start classroom. We run Head Start classrooms at Vernon Street, and those are full day, full year programming. So we combine Head Start money with state funded early care and education programming to allow what's typically a half day program, Head Start, to extend for the full day, and what is typically a school year program, which is Head Start, to extend for the full year. So that's a program for working parents, parents in school, parents who may have a special need, a child who may have a special need, and we also have a contract to take children who, because of abuse and neglect in the home, are in out-of-home care as a support to the family. We have about 50 kids at Vernon Street, ranging from 0 to 4, and maybe 56 kids. I'd have to think about the classroom configuration for a minute. We have 5 classrooms there. So an infant and young toddler classroom, a toddler classroom, and then 1, 2, 3 preschool classrooms. In addition, at Vernon Street School, we have the WIC program, the Women, Infant, and Children program, which is a federally funded nutrition program that helps families, pregnant women and with children up to age 5, I think, they are given nutritional counseling. They have assistance with, we help new moms with breastfeeding counseling, and then they get coupons so that they can go to the store and buy nutritious food for themselves and for their kids.
Are they married, Claire?
You can be married, you can be single. There's an income limitation. There's no family configuration. I think it would be discriminatory if we passed that. We're not allowed to ask them.
Yeah, okay.
So families that are on WIC, many of whom are working or going to school while they're raising young children. And this is to make sure that the children get adequate nutrition. Right?
Does that go like to the literacy program?
They might be working. They might be working for the Northampton schools as a teaching assistant. I mean, the income guidelines are such that people can be working and still qualify for those kinds of programs. So, fuel assistance, many of the people who receive fuel assistance are working. So I'll get to that in a minute. But so WIC has a site here. We also have sites throughout the county. So throughout the two counties, we have a part-time site in Amherst. That we're sometimes at Vernon Street, sometimes in Amherst. We're in Greenfield. We also have a site in Orange, and we serve also Athol and Ware with that program. I think Ware, definitely Athol. So we're covering a big territory of that program.
That's huge.
And we also do some really innovative things that that program are doing. One of them is really helping people understand how they can take those WIC coupons and use them the most effective way when they go grocery shopping. So we'll do grocery tours with people and help them think about what's the best way to spend those WIC coupons to get the most bang for the buck in terms of nutritious and cost-effective food, right? So. One of our staff members, Colleen Paris, who is a Northampton person, is the person who mostly does those tours.
Is the attendance with children, is that bigger than when you were there?
So there's a difference. WIC is a different program. So WIC, kids don't come every day. So they have an appointment to come in and get weighed in on a periodic basis and then be renewed for their WIC coupons, or now it actually is a swipe card.
Okay.
For the child care and Head Start programs, we serve about 700 kids all in. About 580 of them are Head Start kids, and also Head Start kids, but we also have children who are just basic child care without the additional Head Start services. So we serve children in center-based care, like Vernon Street, but we also contract with family child care providers to provide care in their own homes. And we visit those homes and support the provider, and we provide transportation to children to and from the centers in the home if depending on eligibility. We also, as you know, run fuel assistance. That's our largest dollar program.
Yep.
And some of the statistics from last year for the whole region are in this book, so you can see some of those things that we do for the whole region. This year, we're just about closing out the fuel assistance season this year, and we've certified over 7,000 households to receive fuel assistance in the region.
That's huge.
So those families get the equivalent of about one tank of oil. So that doesn't get them through the winter. It may, you know, they're still probably going to need in a winter like this, people need at least two more tanks of oil. But it helps them get partway through this. So the challenges for our families, and I'd say a significant number of fuel assistance folks are seniors, people with disabilities. We have across those groups, we also have a number of veterans, and we have veterans who are also working. And then we have a significant number of working families who just happen to qualify because their income is low.
And you must have had a significant increase because of the bad weather and all that.
What we had was people were very worried, but we didn't get it. We only could give out the money that we had. So remember, oil was down a little bit this year, which was great, we thought initially. And then that really cold snap hit, so people ended up actually kind of in trouble because maybe they thought they were going to do a little bit better. Electric went up dramatically. So our families that heated with electricity were really in trouble. And those families that heated with oil, we're then backing up with electric heaters in order to make up for the fact that they didn't have enough oil. So with oil and propane, you have to have cash on the barrel head if you want to get a delivery. You can't get a delivery unless you're ready to pay, right? So with electric and gas, there's a moratorium on shutoffs till April 15th. So you'll get through the winter, but then you have to pay in order to keep your utilities on for the summer.
They don't have the money.
Well, people start on a payment plan, and then sometimes we get some money from the state, although not this year, to help people at the end with a little bit more. We didn't get any money this year for that. And then sometimes if people, we also have some non-fuel assistance money that we fundraise to help people if they're really in a pinch. So we've done that too. So again, that's our biggest program in terms of dollars. You know, we spend, that's probably, I think we spent $8 million or something on fuel assistance benefits. That fuel assistance program is tied to our weatherization program. So families that are eligible for fuel assistance are automatically eligible for to have their home assessed for weatherization needs. And depending on their income, again, they may be eligible for free heating, weatherization and or heat system repair or replacement. For families who may...
You do that through the electric companies?
We get money from the federal government, and then we contract with private vendors to do the work, which we oversee and then sign off on before they get the payment from the federal government. We pay them.
So most people are eligible, and I mean everyone's eligible to do these through utility companies too, so why is there a need for community action to have their own?
The utility companies also contracted out to people like CET to manage the program. LIHEAP and the weatherization program, which is what we run, is the grandfather of that energy efficiency. The utility companies didn't used to do that. Uh-huh. We've always done that since the early 70s, since the first oil shortage under the Carter administration. Community action agencies did weatherization for very low-income people. Uh-huh. So we continue to do that. We actually also now do work for the utility companies. They contract with us to do work, mostly on multifamilies. So we've managed some big multifamily projects, especially for housing authorities and some other subsidized units. We'll go in and oversee and manage the assessment and then actually the job. Like we'll find the contractors and make sure the work gets done. So that's another piece of what we do. And the utility company portfolio is a bigger part of what we do now than it used to be. Because as a result of the focus on energy use, especially in Massachusetts over the years since in the mid-2000s, and the passage of the Green Energy Bill, the utility companies now have targets for reduction that they have to meet. So they contract with people like CET to do it, and they also contract with people like us to we're part of the statewide community action network that does this kind of work. And we do that work outside of our area too. We've done work in Springfield, we've done work in North Adams. This is all utility company work that we've done.
So you're in charge of that whole?
We have responsibility right for that area. And so, but let me give you an example of a Northampton resident who had a two-family living on Social Security alone, renting one of the apartments and living in the other apartment. The heating systems went in both units. She was eligible because she was, as a senior living on Social Security, she was eligible for fuel assistance, which made her eligible for weatherization for and a heat system for her home. But she still had the tenant. Okay? Because the tenant's system went and it was an old system that was not energy efficient, she was eligible for Columbia Gas to replace the system at no cost to her. So we were able to get her two heating systems because of the way we were able to put the programs together. And the next year she sent us a check for our special heat up fund and thanked us and said, I've saved so much money this year with this efficient system. I don't need fuel assistance this year. Now I might need it in a future year, but I don't need it this year.
Wow.
So it's a very powerful program in that way. It's a program that we offer that just covers basic needs, right? This is a basic need.
Keep warm and safe.
Right, we do run some other basic needs programs, but not in Hampshire County. We run a food pantry in Franklin County. We actually run a food pantry in both in Greenfield, and then we run a food pantry in Shelburne Falls. So, but in Hampshire County, the Survival Center does a great job meeting that need, and so does the Amherst Survival Center. So
clear, if there was a young woman, say in her 40s.
That's young to us now, isn't it?
Went through a divorce.
Yeah.
And did not have a place to live.
So we do, that's good, that's a good segue into something else that we do. We run something called Community Services and Asset Development, which is a program that works, one of the things that we do in that program is the next generation of what was the old first call for help, where you could call and somebody will always be on the other end of the line, and we'll help you figure out what your next steps are, whatever that is.
Yeah.
So you can call and say, I don't have any housing. And one of our first call counselors will help you think about that. They'll either work with you on the phone, or for instance, when somebody is worried about housing, then they do a referral to someplace where they can get housing search.
Yeah.
Or say somebody's worried because their phone is going to get shut off and they have a small child in the home or whatever it is, whatever the problem is. We'll set up a meeting with them. We have a just about certified financial social worker on staff who will go through a financial literacy piece with them and help them figure out how to deal with their bills.
Mm-hmm.
So we do, that department has a big portfolio. Having car problems, let's figure out let's sit down and look at what's going on for you. Looks like you might be eligible for fuel assistance and you're not getting it. That'll help you if you get one tank of oil, that might help you against your car payment, right? Or looks like you might be eligible for SNAP, for nutrition assistance for the food stamp program.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if we can get you on that. Looks like, they'll look at all these different indicators, right? What's going on with you, and let's help you figure out how to manage the money that you have, and let's see if there's some things that you haven't tapped yet that might help you.
Because
and
I know
the other piece of that is that we will help them think about what their next steps are too. So we run a program, and we're not funded right now to do it, but it's a very powerful program that we hope we'll get funding again for, called an IDA program. So that's an individual development account. So somebody comes in and says, I have bad credit, but I have big dreams. I want to do something, and I don't know quite how to get there. We'll put together a cohort of people. They start doing credit recovery. They start saving. We'll match their savings with some money that is fundraised through the banks and others in the community and some federal dollars. We've had people go through that program who have started businesses, who put themselves through college, who put their kids through college, who bought homes, who bought vehicles because they needed a vehicle for their business. Although vehicles aren't theoretically part of the IDA, sometimes that's what they'll end up as a part of the business. They start a business, they're able to to then buy a vehicle, so it's...
How can they save up all that kind of money for a vehicle?
Because they're sitting down and they're figuring out how to manage their finances, and they're in a group of people who are giving them the kind of support that they need. Other people who are in the same circumstance, and they're all working towards a goal. So that's our IDA program, and I remember I said it's community services and asset development? That's the asset development piece. Another piece of our asset development work is that we run the volunteer income tax assistance program that, I'm gonna check the number on this. This is a program where people, we have probably, I think maybe 15 volunteers, maybe more, who will do taxes with people, we do them for free. So if you go into any of the tax preparers, they have to pay.
Right, like the senior center, they're free.
Right, well, that's another volunteer income tax assistance site.
Yeah.
They run it. We run one that's open to anybody, you know, who's with, it's really open to anyone, but really about 60% of the people that come in to meet with us are under the federal poverty guideline.
Okay.
And our goal there is to get, I'm just checking on, here we go. So, we do returns for people, we don't charge them, they get to keep everything that comes back to them. So this year, we got $1.1646 million of refunds for people. And of the EITC recipients, you know what EITC is? The Earned Income Tax Credit. So if you're under a certain level and you're working hard, but you're paying taxes, the federal government will actually give you more than you paid in order to make work pay for you. So we brought back $959,000 of Earned Income Tax Credit back to the region this year out of those. So that's an asset for somebody.
Sure.
Who puts that in the bank and says, okay, now that's going to help me pay. I know I need to get a new car. Here's part of my money to get my new car.
Do or a lot I can of pay my. Know about that?
Well, we had a good turnout this year. We did 528 returns this year through all volunteers now, about a dozen or 15 volunteers, including people from local banks, a teacher from Smith Boat, who won an award from us last year for her great volunteering on this project. It's a really powerful program. And the number of recipients this year that got, number of people who came in to do this program this year, 60% of them got EITC back. And the average income of people who came in this year was $17,000 a year. So this is a critical part of our asset development program, that we're doing financial literacy. We're helping people think about how their money's working. We're doing, when we're funded, we're doing individual development accounts and really trying to create asset development strategies for people. Mm-hmm. And we're doing EITC, which really is an asset that people get when they come in to see us, right? And they go through the process. So very proud of the work that group does. We also do employment work. We have youth programs in both Hampshire and Franklin County. In Hampshire County, community services, the program I just talked about, fuel assistance, and youth programs have an office in Old School Commons in the basement. And the address is, I think, somewhere in here. And we do youth employment, including the summer youth program that we did here last year in Northampton, because Northampton was funded to do that. We do year-round summer youth employment work with teens. In fact, I just met a group yesterday that were doing career exploration and talking about, met with them, and trying to talk, we were talking about how different people get to where they went in their path.
That's almost like service then. Sharing your story?
Yeah. Well, these teens went around and interviewed people throughout the community. So they were interviewing people at a different agency, and then they came over to see me. And they're spending a week during the school break having conversations about employment with people, which is great. One of our staffers. I think in the handout there's a page that has a bunch, right when you get in, the first couple pages have a bunch of statistics in them. You'll see last year's EITC by the way, was $591,000, this year's $900,000. You'll see WIC in there, but I'm looking for the youth programs because the numbers in youth program. 172 young adults participated in our workforce development programming.
How many?
172.
What page
across the region.
Is that?
I'm on the third page in, maybe it looks like this.
Yep. Oh yeah.
And we exceeded all our goals in terms of people either achieving employment or achieving a credential like their GED or finishing high school. We exceeded all the goals there. And we're very proud of that.
So the kids that participate, are they from low-income families,
yes,
per se, or it's,
yes,
a kid that gets defined as low-income because he or she is a kid?
No, it actually comes, well, you know what, we don't worry, we have to worry about incomes to a certain extent, but we also have enough funding sources that we pick up money, you know, so our youth employment is funded primarily through the federal WIA program, or now it's changing to be a different name, a different set of initials, but, and it's primarily moving from focus to both in-school and out-of-school youth to a focus with out-of-school youth. And we've done a lot of work with out-of-school youth. We feel very comfortable about that. But we also get some United Way money that helps us because that's not as tied to income. So you might have a young person who comes in who really needs a service but might not meet one of the classifications that one funding source has given you. So we always try to have another so that we can blend the service together and not say, well, you can't do this, right? So they do a work.
So you get the CDBG, we get United Way.
We get United Way, we get federal WIA money. So we get money from we get CDBG in Greenfield. We get, we usually try to get some community foundation money to do something in the youth, with youth, maybe not necessarily employment, but
yeah,
something with youth. We also run GLBTQ youth support. We run a program called Generation Q, that is a teen, a young person support group for GLBTQ kids, and we also run a program called TREE, which is a support program for trans kids. And those programs both are really critically important for the kids that are engaged in. Last week we had our annual ball for kids that GLBTQ and trans kids over at Flywheel in East Hampton. I wasn't able to go this year, but I heard it was great. And it was about, I think, between 70 and 80 kids attended from the region. We get kids as far away as Springfield, and the county, all the way up, because there aren't a lot of services. So they come to us.
Wasn't there a program right here?
This is the grandchild of that program.
Okay.
So
that was wonderful.
Yeah, yeah. And we also do youth leadership work, so a lot of work on substance abuse, and we have teens who are youth leaders on substance abuse issues. So that's youth programs.
Okay.
Family support programs is not as present in Hampshire County as it is in Franklin County. We have a family center in Greenfield, and we also have something called the Family Resource Center in Greenfield. And that's a new program working with kids birth to 18 or really, so that program's just getting off the ground, and it's a Greenfield Franklin County based program. In Hampshire County, the Family Resource Center is going to be in Amherst.
So who else do you work with, Mary Claire, with other agencies?
So we partner with a number of agencies. We work in partnership with a number of agencies. So, I want to tell you about one other thing.
Okay.
We also do a mediation program. We do a lot of court mediation in the Northampton District Court, and probate court, these are mediations for people who are struggling with, there may be a divorce issue, there might be a landlord-tenant issue,
small claims?
I don't think we do so much small claims anymore.
We used to do small claims through that program.
Yeah, I'm not sure, TMTC is the name of the program.
Right.
We may do some, but
Holyoke used to do small claims.
We still do small claims. We are still doing stuff in Holyoke. TMTC has been around. They were involved in about 1,000 people in mediation last year doing something or other. So, but the other thing about that issue, I want to get back to your question because we meandered off, that that person who may not have housing, they might have come in the door through community services. We also, if somebody's without housing is one thing, but if somebody's on the verge of losing their housing, mediation can be a help sometimes. We also have funding from the federal government to help people with rent if they're at the verge of eviction. And then we do case management with them for a year. So those are the big, kind of the big programs that we do. Again, family support, we do some home visiting here in Hampshire County. We do the parent-child home program. Actually, we don't do parent-child home here. Barbara Black does that. We do healthy families, working with young families.
It's amazing because even on my ward, which people have come to me about community action, and they've connected with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't tell you the respect that I hear about community action.
Well, I feel lucky to be there.
You are very fortunate.
Very passionate employees. People really care about their work. I'll tell you that our early educators, more and more now, are being required to have bachelor's degrees in order to work in the classroom. And we pay them, on average, $26,000 a year. They're eligible for many of our services if they have children.
$26,000 a year?
A year. And they need to have a bachelor's degree.
Are employees unionized?
No. But it wouldn't really make a difference, to be honest, and because that's what the funding source is paying us.
Yeah.
I mean, we have a very good benefit package, but the pay itself is based on what the feds and the state are willing to give us to offer the service.
So apparently, if they take the jobs, the money is not the issue with them.
Well, we people have are very dedicated to the work, but at some point, our turnover rate is going up because people can't afford to stay in the field.
Yeah.
So this year, we're working at the state government level, and I want to thank Peter Kochan, among others, for signing on, and John Seibeck from South Hadley for introducing an amendment to try to get a rate increase on our state rate for our early childhood folks. It's just not enough money.
Can you talk about the funding, the federal versus state, and kind of what the percentages are?
So we get more money. And if you go to the chart that's in, that there's a spreadsheet and a financial section in, more towards the back of the book.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see that on the top where it says sources of funds. At the top where it says sources of funds, you can see that there's a big dark kind of teal, and that says federal funding through state, but it's federal money. So that's most of the child care money, all of the fuel assistance money, and I didn't talk about another pot that I will in a minute, CSPG. All of that comes there. Okay, then you have federal funding direct. That's primarily Head Start. Head Start contracts directly with us. Then you have federal funding through local governments. That's the CDBG that we get, that very tiny slice.
That's a little tiny slice.
Right. And then federal funded direct is Head Start. And then you go around Commonwealth of Massachusetts, about 15%. That's the balance of child care. That's mediation. That's some of our youth program health work that we do on health.
That's at 21.9%?
No, the 15.9. That's some child care, very little of the child care money. Most of the child care money comes directly from the feds. The state matches it to, I think, about 15%. The state match used to be higher, and it's dropped. It used to be, I think, in inflation adjusted dollars, we're $100 million down on child care match. But they're meeting the federal standards, so we're not, you know, if they're barely. So we're looking to try and move that up. We've joined with across the state with other groups to create a coalition called Putting Massachusetts Kids First. And the goal there is to raise salaries of the teachers in order to have them stay in the classrooms.
Is this the bill that you're talking about that Peter and
Peter and John John led and Peter signed on to the amendment to just raise the rate, but we're talking about a multi-year campaign to bring the rate up even higher. Because even right now, Massachusetts pays about 25% on average of what the market rate for child care is, which means that if you're a parent who's living with a low income and you have a child care voucher, many of the private centers simply aren't going to pay because it doesn't pay the rate. So. It's a critical issue. And the other thing about the turnover is that turnover is hugely detrimental to small children.
Yeah.
Can you imagine, Mary Ann, if you had a teacher, a classroom, a third grade classroom at Bryan Road that saw three teachers during the course of the year? The parents would be up in arms.
I believe that.
Our kids have that experience. And I say our kids across the Commonwealth, not our kids in particular. I'm saying across the Commonwealth. Very young children are experiencing that kind of turnover, that kind of disrupted attachment. And for very young children, attachment is the basis for their learning. Mm-hmm. You
they
have to
say
start
that's the critical
with attachment.
Part of it, right?
You have to start because, and then the things they need to learn are the things that are the precursors to cognitive learning, right? Empathy, ability to wait, defer gratification, teamwork. There's a whole set of things that if you don't get them mm-hmm. when you're young, you can get them later. It's just harder.
Right? Time.
And you learn them through your attachment to a caring adult.
Mm-hmm. Now, are you able in your role as the executive director to do kind of the lobby work that
That's
needs
what
to
I
be
do.
Done to,
That's what
that
I
is
do.
Your central?
Yeah. So I do that, and I work with a really great team on program development. We're really good. We have very good department leaders and a good administrative team that works on program development, strengthening the organization. And then I'm also working collaboratively across the state with our other partners.
Well, that's
and
a big
various,
responsibility.
Yeah, the various different things that we work on. So fuel assistance this year, we're lobbying for a $20 million state line item to supplement the federal line item, which has dropped over the last number of years. Mm-hmm. We may or may not be successful in this budget year, but we're not gonna not put out the need for it. Mm-hmm. We're lobbying for the money for the rate for early care and education in order to stabilize the workforce, right? And then the third thing that is a big priority for us this year. So a Head Start, and you can see the Head Start is that bright, that kind of lime green slice, right? Mm-hmm. And that Head Start gives us, the way to think about this is, you have a $1 million program, or is it more than a million? But say you have a $1 million program. It's gonna cost you $1 million to operate that program. Head Start will give you 80% of the cost of running the program, and you have to match it locally. You have to find a match. So when you all voted to help to allow us to be in the Vernon Street School, that helps us. That's a match because we're not paying market rent on that.
Gotcha.
So
okay.
We're allowed to count that as a match, which is
in
huge.
In kind matches as well.
In kind, yeah. Exactly. So most of our match is in kind.
Oh, really?
Some of our matches at parent volunteers count as a match. Yeah. There's a whole set of things that count as matches.
It shows community support.
Right. And when the program was put together in 1964-65, they wanted to make sure that communities actually wanted them there. So the 20% match was a way for a community to say, yes, we actually want Head Start, right? So the state for many years had been giving Head Start some money that then came out to the programs, right? And it was as low as, it came into being in the mid-1980s. It got to a high water mark of about $10 million, and then the budget crunch hit in the mid, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, and it went back down to, I think, 7. And we moved it back up to 8, and then that last year we moved it to 9. And as a part of the 9 C cuts, the new governor cut it back to the 8. We're looking to pull it back up to we actually like to get to 10. Because the in-kind contributions from communities are very hard to get, and this is a helpful mm-hmm. boost to our goal to get to in-kind, because it also counts as our match.
Now, so, with our new governor, because he was looking at cutting some programs and so forth. Is anything going on with that?
I'm going to see how it plays out. You know, he walked into a big hole. I get that.
Huge
hole. You got to figure it out. I get that. And he's also, I remember the first day I walked into the mayor's office.
I remember that too.
What are we doing here?
So he gets a little bit of a pass, right? And he also had like the worst winter weather ever. So, okay. I want to see what the House and the Senate do. To help restore some of it.
That's been
he helped Chapter 70 Harmless, which I thought was really important.
I did.
Elementary
too.
School. Yes. Okay, that's good. I don't know yet that he understands the full value of what the early childhood community is doing. Mm-hmm. We need to educate him on that. So we'll do that.
Are you able to actually kind of have a voice at the federal level as well, or is it more, do you do it through state?
Well, on the federal level, that's a good question. We're actively involved in the National Head Start Association. In fact, I went to the National Head Start annual meeting in Washington in January. We went up to the Hill, met with our legislative, our federal legislators, and talked to them about what we're doing. Various members of the administration came to the meeting and talked about what they're doing. There's some very interesting stuff that the feds are doing, especially in the area of early childhood, full-day, full-year programming, what's called the child care, the child care development block grant. So this is money that comes back to the state. They're looking at changing the regulations there that we think, in ways that we think will be better for kids.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some good things happening there. Now the goal here is to get a good state plan to manage that federal money that's coming down. So we're working on that. On Head Start, I think we've got our ear to the ground and they're doing pretty well. Fuel assistance, which is the other big, big chunk of our federal money. You know, it goes up and, you know, it's gone down, and it really should be going up. But again, we have a federal government that's cutting things. So mm-hmm. we were fortunate to hold our own on Head Start, and we're trying to hold our own as much as we can on fuel. Weatherization actually went up this year because I think people see a value in weatherization. The other core funding, so this is an important piece, the thing that makes us different than every other human service agency, why we're a community action agency, is because we have two things. We have something called a tripartite board, and if you look on the back, you'll see the names of the board members.
Mm-hmm.
We have private representatives, we have public representatives, and those public representatives are either elected officials or appointees of elected officials. So in that case, we mostly state reps and senators, and then we have our congressman, Jim McGovern, has an appointee. And then we have community representatives. That is people who are elected by the low-income community to serve on our board. So the Hampshire County community representatives, we just ran an election and we're gonna have new representatives. But the two that are on here right now have been reelected, and that's Gwen Bass and Karen Mandeville. So they serve on our board. And we just did an election, and we'll have Usually we're at six for that group, and we'll be back up to the six. And then we have some few changes up above, but not a lot. So, and you'll see some Northampton names there. You'll see some Greenfield names there. It's sort of spread out across the region.
Michael Alio, that name sounds familiar.
He ran against Peter Kokot for state rep when Peter first ran.
That's right, okay.
And Peter Kokot appointed him to our board.
He's an attorney in town who works with Bill and Bill.
Hey, Lance, how are you?
Really? Michael Alio?
So the second thing that distinguishes us is that we get some federal money that comes from the state called Community Services Block Grant. We have to use that.
You want the bathroom broken?
Sure, thank you.
We have to use that money on behalf of people living with low incomes to meet six national objectives that include, you know, helping them come out of poverty, strengthening families, whole set of objectives that we have to meet. And we can use that money pretty flexibly. So when I talked about first call for help, you know, that our community services, we use our CSBG to fund those positions so that people can answer the phone. We use that money to fund some of our financial literacy work. We use it to fund some of the VITA work. We use it to help fund that youth employment work that I was talking about, that sometimes we don't have quite enough money. We can use CSBG to do that. This past year, given the debacle that's going on with food stamps, SNAP benefits, we increased the amount of money we spent on buying food for our food pantry so that people have food. We've actually spent money at the food pantry to make sure that people living in hotels in Greenfield were able to get food when they came to the motel, because they'd all been alive with nothing. So
this business with these motels with families, you know what I'm talking about.
Very difficult.
Children.
Yeah. Hampshire County, interestingly enough, doesn't see this, but Franklin County is over 100, been up, you know, hundreds of people living in a motel. So it's been very difficult. So we can use that CSBG money pretty flexibly to serve various kinds of needs in the community, as long as people are at or below 125% poverty.
Claire, what kind of accountability do you have to the feds and to the state? I mean, do you apply each year for this?
So that's a good question. The CSBG, you have a designation. As long as you meet the requirements, you keep the designation. So we have the designation. We have a certain set of requirements that we have to meet in terms of reporting. We tell them what numbers we hope to achieve and what goals we hope to achieve. And then we have to report that, and assuming we're on track and we're not wasting our money, we're okay. They're actually changing that and starting to look, instead of looking at outputs, this is how many people you serve, they're starting to look at outcomes. And we've been moving in that direction anyway, so we're happy to think about that.
And do you do internal kind of evaluative processes?
We do, and in fact, yeah, we do. And in fact, the database issue that I was talking about, we've just converted to a new database that will allow us to look at both inputs, outputs, and outcomes.
Yeah.
So that we can really see all of that. And so we're thinking.
Do you have different, you have to do some to the feds, some to
the
state?
Yes, we have probably 65 or 70 different funding sources, and each one of them has a different reporting requirement. So every one of them we figure out how we're going to report.
Business office, do you have, how many people do you actually have?
And for that, for the business office, we have six people.
How many?
It's amazing that six people can handle all of that.
For about, a budget of about $28 million. So the other thing is that pie chart, when you look at it, the bottom of the pie chart tells you how much of that money just passes right through and goes out to various vendors. And that big teal piece on the bottom, that dark one, that is child care providers, weatherization contractors, and fuel assistance primarily. So our core business is paid for out of the other half, right? And then we have staff, so we have fuel assistance staff that their job is to certify that somebody's eligible for fuel assistance. And then for that, they pay the bill. We have, so the business office doesn't do that. But they're reconciling everything, and they're doing the payroll, and they're doing all that other stuff.
Hi. Do we have more time? Can I ask you another couple of questions? So in terms of the recipients of your services, do you have guidelines in terms of can people who are undocumented in this country access services?
For CSBG, there are no requirements to be documented. But for services that are strictly funded by CSBG. Other services, depending on the service, there are some requirements, and so we have to deal with
that.
And so the other question along those similar lines are, do you work with people who are actively using, addicted, that kind of thing, so you don't have kind of guidelines that people from the services based
on. If you need fuel assistance, you get fuel assistance. You don't make a judgment about it. You know, we are going to, if you call up and say, I'm in financial ruin, and it turns out in the course of the interview process that you're using, or you have an alcohol drug problem, we're probably going to talk to you about that. Doesn't mean we won't work with you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But we're going to talk about it because it's part of the picture.
How would they know that, though?
Well, so if somebody comes in and says, here's my budget, here's my earnings, and we say, okay, where did $200 go? And they say, oh, I spent it on, we might have a conversation. doesn't mean that we're not going to serve them.
But it doesn't disqualify them.
No. The only disqualification, almost the only disqualification for us is income. If you're over income for our services, then you can't serve you, right?
Yes.
But if we can fit in for some immigration status, right? And for many immigration status, because the governments have moved to that disqualification, but that's not true for CSBG. So, and the thing about income as disqualification, we have services that are eligible for people different places on the spectrum. So, WIC is at 200% of poverty, I think, CSBG is at 125%, everybody's in a different place. So we're going to work with people to do a screen and say, okay, maybe you can get this, even if you can't get that. Maybe we can help you with this, or maybe we can do this. And then the other thing we do, and we do this increasingly, is we have people asking us to manage money for them. So in the Hilltowns, we have a couple of the towns that have done CBG, and they have us giving additional fuel payments for some families in their communities that can't quite make it on the fuel payment. So when we screen them, and you're living in, I'm going to make this up because I'm not sure it's one of our town, but you're living in Leiden, all the fuel assistance out there. Well, Leiden has put it, you know, said that if you're qualified in their community, you can get an additional $100, and we're going to give you the additional $100. We also have our own pot of money that we can do that with, and we use it pretty liberally if somebody's struggling with their fuel bill, and they have cash, and they can choose to either, you know, pay the rent or buy their fuel, we'll say, well, you know, we'll buy the fuel, you go ahead and pay your rent. And we'll pay your rent, you buy glass, you know, so we'll work.
Gotcha. We have to have prodigious amounts of knowledge, it seems like, to be able to navigate. navigating
our resource advocates are pretty awesome. Our resource advocates that do that kind of work. And every one of our, so we have resource advocates, we have home visitors that need to know this stuff, we have family support workers that need to know this kind of, so everybody, not everybody knows everything, but everybody knows that they can call community services if they have a question. Yeah, and it's a complicated puzzle, but think about it from the point of view of somebody who's living alone. It's a complicated puzzle, and we make it really hard to be a poor person here. You have to travel here to give this person the information about your income. You have to travel there to give somebody else information about your income. If you live in Hampshire County, and I've been yelling about this for years, you have to go to Holyoke, because that's where the welfare is. So we're really, and I've been yelling about this forever.
That's not good.
So we, you know, to the extent that we possibly can, we like to try to help people right at the desk when they walk in. So we, UMass, we work through UMass, we do SNAP, food stamp certifications right at the desk, we do that. We can do fuel assistance right at the desk. We can help people get onto health insurance, and we do that. In fact, last two years in the winter, we run campaigns, door-to-door campaigns, knocking on doors in Franklin County, 2 years ago in Hampshire County, saying, are you on health insurance? If you're not, here's who you can call. So.
If so, we have Social Security in Holyoke. How come they don't look at opening another office so that we're not going to have this problem?
You know, I have to say that I think the single biggest failure, I'm amazed I think that's what I do. You know, Governor Will closed the welfare office. And that meant that New Hampshire County people were a lot more different. So I know that there are families that moved to Holyoke because it was made their life easier. Made their life harder.
Much harder.
Right? And so if they want economic segregation in cities, then do that. If you want economically integrated cities, then offer the services so that people who are looking for opportunity can stay. You know, school choice, it went up from Holyoke to Northampton because families had to move to find affordable housing and to be close to their services. So I think it's a real failure of state government, and they still, I mean, for a while we had a satellite office at the Skills Center, but it didn't, and now it's really gone anywhere.
Ridiculous.
It's not good. It's
no,
bad,
that is not
bad.
Good. I agree.
So, now in Franklin County, in Greenfield, we're working with the mayor to identify a pot of CDBG money to create a human service center somewhere in downtown Greenfield where we would locate our family center, our fuel assistance, our central administration office, our community resources and advocacy office, food pantry, all that stuff would be in one place. And we're partnering with a couple of other agencies.
Did Tom check it over?
In Hampshire County, our point of entry for this side of the river is at South Street. And people can go into South Street.
Is he okay with it?
Old school buildings. And see fuel assistance, see community resources and advocacy, that's by appointment. But then call the number and they can get the money. And youth programs. And then WIC and child care and full day, full year child care and Head Start at Burner Street. In Amherst, we have a site in North Amherst that has a Head Start classroom. And then we have the child care site next door to Washington School. And then we have a part time site down in Ware where we do dual assistance and community service.
Do you think there's a possibility like we could talk with Senator Rosenberg and Copeland about at least looking at a small office?
I've had this conversation forever. I can't tell you how many times I've had the conversation. It's on nobody's radar as important.
I think it's very important.
I think it's important.
There's some way, just because I think we're kind of wrapping up a little bit, is there some concrete ways in which European counselors can assist?
Well, I think your support of, I know you did a resolution about moving a young child, to the extent that you can support our work in early education. And our, you know, we have a good partnership, continued good partnership with the public schools. And as you may know, Barbara Black was the director of the child care program at Burner Street
right.
before before I was. So she knows that very well, and actually another one of her ladies. The support kids around one of your schools is really, really important. And the support kids historically comes to the CDBG. I'll send you the, our budget priorities, and you can think about what you want to do that. You know, just in general, this putting Massachusetts children first campaign, you may want to think about, do you want to sign up?
I'd like the suggestion that Councilor Klein just brought up, and I think it would be great if we could, and our committee do something to support community action.
Well, I appreciate the time, and I will get you, I'm working on data, and I will get you something. I'm trying to figure out how to do it city by city.
I just wanted to let you know that, you know, the counselor from Ward 4,
she told me.
Right.
And I know I was supposed to say something else. We're partnering with this group called, Susan Crane, who used to be at DCF, is doing a walk for Massachusetts children, and she's walking from Boston to Pittsfield. And we're helping her on the leg from Belchertown to Northampton, and we're all invited to walk 18 miles. And you might not want to do that.
What is that?
So you're also invited to a reception for the walkers, which is going to be at the Edwards Church on May 5th at 5 p.m.
Is that Saturday?
No, it's a Tuesday.
A Tuesday?
Yep.
When is the walk?
It starts at like a couple, you know, like a week before or something. I don't know. I think they're doing like 15, 18 miles a day. So I'm just going to confirm the date.
Where's the walk starting from?
Boston
to Pittsfield.
Yeah, so 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock's the reception.
Yep.
Edwards Church.
Edwards Church, and you're invited. It's a, if you want to bring something to share, you're welcome to do that. It's a little bit potluck, but the Edwards Church is our partner on this, and they're helping us host it. So they've been great about that.
Do you have anything you can send out to the council?
Yes, I'll send you something.
Yes.
I'll send you that. Okay?
Yeah, nice little flyer or something we can mention at City Council.
I will, and if anybody wants to walk, the information is on there.
Oh, that's, let's see.
Can you walk just a mile or two of the?
That's what I'm doing.
You don't happen to know the route from Belchertown?
I don't, but I think it's probably right along the line. Yeah, right on the side.
It's like work right by there, I just join you and walk for.
Yeah, I'll get you the information.
Amherst or Hampton.
Yeah, Jesse Dean, who's our, you know, does everything, is the person in charge of this. So when I send you the information, I'll give you that. Okay, great.
Thank you very, very much.
Take care.
Thanks.
Bye, Glenn.
Hello.
How are you?
Hi, how are you?
Great. My work is done.
Your work is done.
Rebecca.
Yes.
You're up, sweetie.
All right.
Hey, Claire.
How are you?
How are you?
Great. I have no complaints. You doing all right?
I'm achieving a lot.
I know, I'm up in Greenfield all day.
How's that going up there?
I like it. Hang in there for a minute, honey.
Okay.
But as long as mom, we can, will you take?
There you go.
These are for Mary Ann. Mary Ann, I found a couple more.
Thank you.
All right, so Steve didn't make it, huh?
Steve's in California.
Oh, the poor guy.
Yeah.
Poor guy's in California.
Thank you for being a jerk, Jeff.
Yeah.
You good?
Thank you, Mary.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you.
How are you? Good to
see you. How are you, dear?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Okay.
All right.
I would like to introduce Rebecca
Twining,
and she's taking the place of Steve Connors, who, because of our change of date, Steve could not be here today. So Rebecca is going to give the year-to-date veterans services expenditures and the 2016 projected budget.
Correct.
Thank you.
And
do you know Councilor Alyssa Klein from Ward 7?
On my first page of my packet is the expenditures for July 1st of 2015 to April 22nd of 2015. I've broken down the account names with the budgeted amount, the amount that has been used to date, and currently what is remaining in each of our accounts. This is the first box. The second box, do I have to read what's in each account? Or can I? No, okay. And then my second box is the FY16 budgeted amount. It's the same current amount. It was a level service, the same across the board this year as it was last year. Obviously, no money has been spent. We're currently looking at $776,130 for FY16.
So it's actually less, though, when you said it was level funded.
Yes, they actually did an, you're right, Veterans Benefits, they did an assessment, and they felt that dropping it, because we're not hitting our $679.5 this year, that they would drop it. Mm-hmm. And Susan Wright did an average of what she thought we would spend for next year.
Okay. She usually does that.
Yeah. So she took care of dropping it by a few. The second page is the House Bill number 3319, which was a bill that was put out by Tricia Farley Bovier. And it is a bill to, they want to centralize the veteran services. They would like to let the town officials go and hire just a few to do a regional office like the Department of Transitional Assistance. And that is the bill.
On this bill?
Yeah.
Okay. Which I was just talking with Tim about this.
That's right, yeah.
And specifically because I've read it, it's where they actually want to go ahead and do away with our veteran agents.
Yes.
Correct?
Correct. Yeah. They'll centralize, they'll have one office per every county across the Commonwealth, and they'll hire their own people who will then become state employees instead of city.
Exactly, which will make it very difficult for our veterans, both men and women, of finding a way to get from A to C or whatever.
That is correct. And then the last page of my packet is the veterans oppose the bill to eliminate local veterans agents. And that was with WGGB and Ray Herschel Thursday at our office with Steve Connor. And I just printed out the article of what was said.
I appreciate you doing that.
That's
because I just want to explain, Councilor Connor, that I don't know if you saw that on Facebook about this occurring, about this bill. This state rep from Pittsfield, apparently she had brought it into the State House, that's when it was brought in January. It has caused a huge outcry right now on opposition. And Steve Connors was actually talking on Facebook about the bill. That's how I got to know about it just this week. And the select board from Belchertown have written a letter in opposition of this bill to this state rep from Pittsfield. I don't know her.
Well,
I don't think I've ever
seen
her.
Is the motivation that it's going to be a money saving?
Every time the state gets involved, it costs more.
What had happened here, she was saying that people were coming to her and her district complaining that that would be a good way to go because we're using taxpayers' money in each town or city.
Because currently we
use state money, we're not using
tax. Then the city doesn't have to pay the upfront cost because it takes a year for the money to be reimbursed. So
leave our veterans behind again for the moment.
Thank you.
I really appreciate you getting this because I wanted Alyssa. And did you bring another packet with you?
I gave Pam,
was that?
Yes, I gave her two packets.
Okay, because once you get going to Alyssa Klein.
No, I never. How about Jean Louise?
I mean, yeah.
Yeah. So well, she has a packet for her as well.
Yeah. Okay, I appreciate that she gets that bill also. But I talked with Councilor Dwight, shot him off an email, regards to what I saw on this bill and about us writing a letter of opposition. And Rebecca
I spoke to Steve, and he said that he would be more than willing to help with the language. I do have a letter that somebody wrote in opposition of it in my email, but it came from another veteran service officer who wrote, and there's actually one online from the VFW that was posted.
Is that the one from Belchertown, maybe, possibly?
I don't think it was from Belchertown. I think it was from somewhere in mid-state.
Oh, okay. Because there's also something written on Facebook from this veteran from the VFW.
Was in front of his board of selectmen, and that's what else.
I think maybe at our Veterans Day event at Look Park, we should have veterans sign a letter to the Speaker of the House and the Governor.
And it also needs to be sent to the state rep in Pittsfield, who is the one who has designed.
I would say, you know, I would ignore her, and I would send one to the Governor, and I'd send one to the House of Representatives.
Wow.
I think to our local reps, actually. Is there a sense of how much traction this bill is actually getting? Is it something that will move out of committee and actually make it to the floor of?
That I'm not sure. I just see a lot of the editors, they're opposing the bill.
Yeah.
I haven't seen many people are for it. I mean, maybe certain towns are, because they don't, the smaller towns, I think, have a harder time coming up with the funds and then waiting a year to get the funds back.
Right.
I think those are the ones that would be in support of it.
And look at our veterans agent, Steve. I mean, we have expanded, you know, to fulfill what we have.
Well, basically, it is almost regional.
Yeah, he's covering a lot of territory.
Yeah, we have ten communities.
Awful.
Ten. And Tom just got West Hampton.
No, I that would have to go through the mayor. I don't think it, I don't know if that is.
Because a newsletter we get in town said that Tom Garrett was now the veterans agent.
Oh, really?
In West Hampton?
Yeah.
I didn't.
Well, he's got the other hill towns. He's got Lansbury, he's got Chesterfield.
So that makes, so that would be Steve Connor having it, and that I don't think went through the mayor.
Well, I talked to Steve about it when I saw him, a week ago or something, I guess.
Nothing went through the state either, so I don't think it's ours. Yeah, I think they maybe had a mistype, because it wouldn't be Tom, it would be Steve, because Steve is the director.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know.
I don't know if that's accurate.
I told Steve I'd bring the thing tomorrow night, but he won't be there, so.
So does Steve think that he would like to see us councilors write a letter?
Oh, I'm sure.
In opposition? I mean, did he say that to you?
Yes, he thought that was a great idea.
I think the more opposition we can show, the.
That's why I'm doing this.
Better off.
Exactly. So I think with the bill, we might be able to get some language out of that.
Like you said, I have the mother letters on my email.
Yeah.
Send them off to you and you take some language from there if that helps. Steve will be back also on Monday.
Well, it sounds like Steve is going to offer some language for this, so I think we should wait and see what he has.
So could you have him email it to Alyssa and do you know where we share or not?
Sure. He has our email addresses. He can email it to Pam too, so it might be the easiest way to do it.
She's got all her email addresses. Do you know exactly where is this bill right now in the state house?
Well, it was given a bill number and then it was given a house.
Must be referred to committee.
Well, this is what we're trying to find out, where is it?
It was given a bill, it was given a bill number, so it has went through the house because it changed from 3319 to, I think it's HD 1159, I want to say it is.
Docket number 1590.
What page is that on?
On the front of it.
Oh.
So it's made it out of committee and it was, but it wasn't approved. It's not going to the Senate yet, correct?
That is correct.
It was filed on 1/15/2015.
Correct. I'll do a little research this evening and find out where it is.
Who started this?
The state rep.
Representative from.
State representative from Pittsfield.
Farley Bouvier.
She's a woman there. I've never seen her. Do you know her?
I don't know who she is.
I
And she's got seven co-sponsors.
She does?
Yep.
Look at that. She's got seven co-sponsors.
The closest is Brian Ash from Springfield.
Brian Ash?
Carlos Gonzalez, I don't remember who this is from, also from Hinden. Okay, that's good to know. I'll look into it.
That state rep, her name is Tricia, is it Tricia Farley Bolvier? And then she has the 14th Worcester District, James J. O'Day also, who has signed the petition with her. Alan Sylvia, 7th in the Bristol area. Brian Ash, 2nd Hamden District. Denise Provost, 27th Middlesex. Chris Walsh, 6th Middlesex. Carlos Gonzalez, 10th Hamden District. And Joseph D. McKenna, 18th Worcester District. So she's got some sponsors there. Did you hear about this, Bill?
I heard about it.
Into a committee?
It can
like
die
that?
In committee.
It
oh,
can
die
there.
Yeah,
it could.
That's why I was asking if it's getting traction. Does it look like it's actually going to move to the floor of the House or not?
Well, if it's been in committee since January when it was filed,
it may not be.
It may not move any farther.
It doesn't mean we shouldn't write a letter
exactly.
of opposition, but it seems fairly likely that it's not going to make it through this session.
I think that letter would be helpful, just like the select board who's in Belchertown sending it. I think it shows more, a little bit more power coming from towns and so forth. If I was...
Half of these guys will sponsor a bill they have reading red. No, that's true.
Well,
I mean,
it's based on handshakes or the
return
of favor.
Exactly.
Favor
exactly.
for
favor.
Favor returning.
Yeah.
Happens every day, Tim.
Yeah, I know.
Not in our city council.
No. I mean, who wants to be bothered with favors? Because that's not me. And I'm going to be very honest about that. To me, if I was a state rep, that would be the least thing on my mind to ever do a bill, something like that. Especially coming from a military family, both sides, even if I wasn't. People who serve our country, okay? People who have passed away, both men and women, and people now that are serving our country. Do they deserve this? I do not think so. I could never be a sponsor for something like that.
Oh, you dropped something.
Oh, I'll grab it, Brad.
Okay, right now. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Very, very much.
No problem.
I appreciate that. Don't you fall, Tim.
No. Okay.
All right, so we have Brad LeBay with us, and he is the president of the Northampton Veterans Council, and Tim Daly, who also is vice president and chair of activities, and I want to thank you both for being here today. So, Brad, are you going to be talking first, or Tim?
Tim's going to.
Tim, go right ahead.
Tim. Well, it seems like every year we come up with one more event, and this year we've done Armed Services Family Appreciation Day.
I've got one, so we got one.
And that is going to be on May 23rd at Look Park, and it's free to veterans and their families, and pretty much you can see, those are the small postcards that we're sending out to different organizations. so I thought maybe you folks would like to have one.
I wanted to let you know.
Nice design, that. It's a nice design.
I know.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you have a professional graphic designer do that?
No, I think it was Peggy Pease that did it, to be honest.
That's what I thought, too.
It's nice.
Yeah, what, who made those up?
Yeah.
No, well, they were done, the print, they were the design.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Peggy did.
I wanted to let you know, too, you know, the big one that you gave me?
Yeah.
I brought it down to Pat Shaughnessy at the senior center. It is there, and it's hung out.
You could just put one here on the bulletin board as you're leaving as well. Do you have an extra one?
I've got an extra small one I can put on there.
Great.
So that's our added event for this year.
So you're gonna talk about it, right?
And basically, it's gonna start with a run at 9:30 that's being put on by World War II Club.
5K.
It's a 5K fun run, but it's a timed run, so they get credit for it. And then the rest of the day, and Look Park has really gone out of their way to help us. They're giving us the bracelets for the paid for half price for the children. So we're trying to raise some money for that. And basically there'll be food, a DJ, you know, live band. We have a group that is doing kayaking with wounded veterans. They're gonna bring a couple of the kayaks up and use them on the pond. For the paraplegics, I'm trying to think of the name of the bicycle. But anyway, they're gonna have bikes there for demonstration. The VA is supporting us, and the soldiers' home. And so it should be a very busy day. It cuts into my crunch because I still have the cemetery to set up for Memorial Day, but we'll work around it.
And I think we need to talk a little bit more about the publicity, how hard I've attended two of their meetings. You were Israel at that point. And I was invited to attend that at the VFW. And I've helped them. They're going on a building with show. And Bill got a hold of Tommy Pease last week.
Yes.
Tommy left me a message thanking me and our committee. They are going on Bill Newman's. And I've talked with Al from NCTV, and they're going to be doing a live interview for them to get the contact and the exposure.
Right.
I also, at the second meeting, brought up about how about a proclamation of having that done. And they are, I talked with Joe, everything is all set up. Tommy Pease and coming to City Council?
Yeah, Tom, Tim, myself.
Right. Okay, doing
for the proclamation.
Okay, right, but the presentation is going to be done by who's doing it at City Council?
The mayor.
The mayor?
No, no, no. You're coming in to do a presentation May 7th at City Council.
Tom Pease is going to do that.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Yeah.
Then for the proclamation, the mayor will be handing it to all you guys that are going to be there, which will be on May 7th also. So I try to coincide it so both could be done that night and give them the visibility on that. And right now it's trying to get a hold of Channel 40, Channel 22, somehow contact them. If we could get them to come to Look Park, they of that benefit.
I think they've already been contacted.
When?
I believe that Tom had talked about that. So I think.
No, because he mentioned at the last meeting that they had not contacted yet.
I think.
Have they did now?
I think it's happened. Oh no, definitely tomorrow night.
We have a meeting tomorrow night.
We have our regular whole council meeting tomorrow night.
Oh, good.
At the Legion.
So we'll bring it up.
I'll bring it up at the meeting. So this started in a discussion, and it's progressed to this point, but I think it's good. I think that if we do get participation from the community, it'll be good. And it might make a lot of the veterans aware that there is a Legion, that there is a VFW, that there is a Veterans Council. So, you know, the publicity of it, I think, is good. There's a lot of us that are on this council that are getting up in age, and it'd be nice if we had some younger blood coming along.
Well, at the meetings, I saw a couple of guys that were younger. The one that was sitting at your table, he seemed very motivated. I was very impressed with him.
Yeah, he's, but like I say, you know, I've been doing this for 13 years, and I'm getting a little tired, you know. Anyway, lead ceremony will be Sunday, May 24th, and that's at 1 o'clock.
Well, that time's going by quick.
Yeah, well, May is a busy month for us.
For everybody.
Of course, Memorial Day Parade and cemetery will be on May 25th. And
oh,
then,
that's what I wanted to ask you on May 25th. What time does that parade start over by Rogers Bike Shop?
10 o'clock.
That's when it takes off at 10 or 11?
Yeah, 10 o'clock.
Thank you.
Veterans Day takes off 11, but Memorial Day is at 10 o'clock.
Thank you.
Yep. And this year,
we should have put that down here.
Yeah, that's
the times,
well,
yeah.
The
no,
lead
ceremony says at 1 on the.
Leads is at 1 o'clock. Yep.
Now, are you driving in a vehicle for that parade or walking?
I drive.
That black car that you did for St.
No, I ride with Jerry Clark.
Oh, okay.
In his car.
I pick up the parade.
He drives
the parade
van.
I pick up all the guys that get the parade organized. And we just make the loop once, and I park, and then so we don't make the loop the second time, so that they can get in the park, because we need one there for the band, we need one there for the girls to put the flowers out, we need to get the cannon set up.
That's
and,
true. That is true.
You know, so
a lot of work.
Well, it's
a busy weekend.
And
wow.
Sunday
especially
afternoon after Leeds, we usually have a rehearsal at the cemetery.
We go from Leeds down to Florence, another cemetery, and we have a rehearsal for the next day.
Do you go down to St. Mary's Cemetery where the veterans memorial is? Do you guys also like that?
That's Veterans Day.
1900 and some odd flags in St. Mary's Cemetery.
Where that monument is?
No.
I'm talking about that beautiful monument.
The gravestone.
With all the bricks.
The gravestones and ground markers for veterans is open 1900 in St. Mary's Cemetery.
Wow.
There's a lot of flags.
How many bricks are labeled already over there at that
I
monument? It's beautiful.
I haven't even seen it.
Oh, you gotta be kidding. Brad's got how many?
I bought 7.
Yeah, and we got 3 because my husband's 2 brothers and him, so he's
well,
there
were 5 brothers. And they're all deceased, except me, and somebody told me about this, so I said, I better put them all down. And then Carol's brother, he was a Vietnam veteran, a colonel, so I bought one for him, and one of my brothers, his wife, was a veteran, so I bought one for her. So and we're right in front of the flagpole.
And we're 2 rows down from you.
You're 2 rows down.
It's like
it is. It's
not
an,
Leeds.
It's
it
very
Leeds,
impressive, isn't it?
My husband's other 2 brothers are up on
nice.
Yeah, I,
it's beautiful.
It's nice there.
I want to check it out to see how many women's names are on there.
Oh, gee, there must be a lot of them.
I bet you.
Yeah, there are. There are a lot of them.
How about the ones up in Leeds? Have you ever checked the stones out on that?
I don't think we got any veterans in Leeds that are female.
I don't think so. Yeah.
Huh. Wow.
Anyway, the private flag burning is going to be at the World War II Club again this year, and they haven't given me a date. I won't get a date on that until, but that is collection of all the flags from the VFW, from the Legion, from the Elks, and...
Oh, that's right, you rotate, huh?
Yeah.
All around.
Yeah, well, the Legion did it the first 2 years, and this is the second year for them. But the first year we did it...
I thought we did it at the Elks.
No, if you wait a minute, I'll explain that. This is the mass flags. We're burning 1,000 flags. We don't do that on Flag Day.
Okay.
Flag Day at the Elks is just a couple of flags. It's the ceremony.
It's just a ceremony. It's just so that the public understands the tradition of burning the flags.
We get so many flags over the year that we have to have a private...
But you take care of the flags that are the city-owned flags that go up kind of on different...
Yeah.
You do?
We do.
Oh, okay.
And all the flags from the cemeteries and everything, we have to take care of it.
Yeah.
So it's a big, it's all day.
Right, see, at one point, they didn't have very much money.
Yeah.
So they, Tommy Pease and them came to me and said, we need help. So I had a meeting with the mayor.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, we did.
And you helped us.
We were able to get some money for that to help them. They were in town.
Well, that's what we're taking out of our own pockets. No, I'm serious.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So anyway,
I'm having a problem with my ears, so I'm deaf in one ear, and I'm having a hard time with the other one, so... If I look at you stupidly,
no, that's because
it's just that I didn't catch you, you know?
And then Flag Day this year, fortunately, will fall on Flag Day, and that'll be at the Elks, and that'll be like 2 o'clock in the afternoon, that ceremony will start. There'll be an ad in the paper and news on that.
You will get an email sent to us so we can announce that at City Council too?
Yeah.
About Flag Day, please, if we don't have the information.
Well, the problem is your meeting here was before our April meeting, so I...
No, but that's okay.
When we put this together, put
the exact time for all of them, whether they're open to the public or not, we'll make announcements.
Well, Flag Day, the Flag Day ceremony on June 14th is open to the public. And of course, the Pulaski Day Parade, we've been asked to support that, and we've done that. And we've reserved November 7th is our annual salute to Veterans Breakfast. That'll be at the Elks.
They do such a wonderful job.
Well, Seth really gives us a break on the cost of the food, and the Elks donate the building so that we don't have to pay like we did at Smith School and at the Senior Center.
Senior Center, we had to pay. Smith School, we had to pay. And
amazing.
It is.
Yeah,
the Elks were very good to us.
It was costing us almost $400 for the breakfast at Smith School because we had to have somebody from their kitchen staff there. We had to have the janitor there the night before, and he was getting overtime so that we could set up for the...
And we did all the work.
So
we set the hall up. We did everything, even down at the Senior Center.
So, anyhow,
we're better off.
We're better off. We're better off.
More parking, out in the country.
And of course, Veterans Day Parade will be in downtown Northampton.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that the park is done or is not torn up so that I like to keep the people back off the street ever since that.
I haven't got the slightest idea. Have you heard anything
when they're breaking ground down?
Well, if it isn't, maybe by tradition, what we may do is start the parade in the center of Hamp, and we'll go to Lamprin Park in front of the Bridge Street School, if this isn't done. I really hate to do that with the memorial out here, but if this is all tore up,
but they might
ever since I saw that kid almost get hit out here in front that year, that's why we moved it into the park.
Yeah, we're better off.
And
at the park.
We used to, years ago, go down to Lamprin Park.
Right.
And that's where we held it.
That's right. We held it right at the flagpole in Bridge Street Cemetery.
Yep. That's where we used to hold the ceremony.
They marched from John Green Hall.
Yep.
To Bridge Street.
Well, I remember marching all the way from the city barns. Yeah, with Buffer Hurley and all, and hundreds.
And then.
So that is something we should find out, Rebecca, okay, for November 11th, because there is some concerns from the Veterans Council here. Is there going to be any movement at the Pulaski Park?
We can't use the park, we'll probably reverse it.
We'll reverse the parade and use Lambert Park.
Get right, down right at the.
So we should get that information.
Well, we got plenty of time before November. I mean, because we always.
But that's okay, let me finish, because that way she can check it out with the department heads on that, to see if, like, what the Department of Public Works and the planning department, I mean, quite a bit of them are involved in this.
Yeah.
So even if you do know ahead of time, then you'll know.
Oh, that's fine, you know, but I'm saying, we're prepared either way.
We'll do it.
We've discussed it. I mean, we're going to have Veterans Day parade.
Do you have anything in Westhampton? Because you're from Westhampton. Do they do anything?
Yeah, they always have a Veterans Day, but because I belong to the Legion and the Elks here, you know, my kind of my loyalty is with Northampton, and I mean, I was born here.
So they don't have anything, a veterans area in Westhampton?
I don't know what Westhampton does.
Oh, they do? Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah, they do Memorial Day and Veterans Day.
Up at Westham?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I have several friends who lived there forever, and they've never talked about.
Yeah, they do it. They march from the old school.
Yeah.
To the center of town.
Really?
Yeah, and they have the regional band there and everything, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, they usually do it on.
Like Chesterfield?
That's a very motivated town.
Yeah, but the guys that are the active ones there are getting older too.
You know what?
Everybody's getting older. You can't stay younger. Which we could.
And our last event is, of course, Pearl Harbor Day at the bridge.
Were you going to say something before, Brad?
Yeah, up on the top of this, right above the Arm Appreciation Day, I was going to say, that was added this year.
Yeah, I said.
Yeah.
Oh, you mentioned.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
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 That is a really packed weekend, boy.
It is for us.
Especially when you.
This is all day Saturday.
It starts Friday, and it goes all the way through to Monday, and then Tuesday to do all the tear down.
It's pretty hard commuting from New Hampshire to here.
Thank you.
Okay.
You know.
Who's coming?
Latashi. No, I have a camp in New Hampshire, and you're saying that's a busy weekend, and that's a good camping weekend too. I give that all up to come down here.
Priorities.
Yeah.
I'm in trouble on the home front tonight, you know.
Do you remember where is the donations coming from at that last meeting that I attended? For all the hamburgers, hot dogs, and cheeseburgers.
It's coming from the DAV, the VFW, the Legion, and the Elks.
Wasn't something mentioned about cereals? Somebody check out with cereals or
something? Oh, they're getting it.
That's where we get our stuff.
Yeah, okay.
They get great.
Oh, also too, another thing that Steve Connors brought up at that last meeting at the VFW was that he was able, his sister apparently works for the rec department in our city.
Yeah.
And he came back with good news that Anne-Marie Moggio and the rec department is coming in to help with this appreciation day for all the different types of activities for the children and stuff. It is. And it is free, and it's all of Western Mass.
Yeah.
That's huge. And they've been working tirelessly.
Well, this isn't as bad as planning the trip to D.C.
Oh, no, that
in 6 months, we.
I know.
We also sent letters to all the businesses in Northampton.
for this?
To ask for a donation, yeah.
For donation.
Yeah.
Did you get a good response?
I haven't had a meeting yet to find out what's coming.
We'll probably find out tomorrow night, yeah.
You didn't get one of those?
Like Florence Savings Bank, the new banks right on King Street, you should go to them.
It's all been done.
You've done?
We have a pretty good list from the trip.
Did you go to the bank? No, those banks were not there.
No, I know those banks weren't there.
No, but you should have, they're pretty good.
I think Tom and Peggy put together a list.
Yeah, well, it started from.
It started with the bus tour.
Okay.
Yes, it did.
That's when it really started.
How much did you raise for that tour?
$26,000.
Almost $27,000 in it.
That paid.
In a matter of how many months, Tim?
It was actually 5 months that we raised the money.
Oh, yeah, big time.
That was quite a thing. And you worked your, you know what, off to help us on that. Yeah, she did, we had beautiful, with the Elks.
Yep.
Yep, raised a lot of funds. And the banks were really good to us.
Wonderful.
Brad and I went to the Florence Savings Bank and locked out $100,000.
Yep.
What stores do you have this hung up in? In the Florence area, up in Leeds?
They're mailing them out.
Yeah, they're.
They're mail outs.
Yeah, those are mail outs, the big ones have been distributed.
Oh, they have?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't see anything in Northampton.
There's one in Cereal's Pharmacy that I gave Brian Joyce to bring down there.
Right, that's it?
And, well, that's the one I did, but.
She's talking like in public places, there's, it's very few and far in between, right?
Yeah, I don't know, I can't answer for everyone.
I should talk with Tom and see if he has any more flyers, because I know business people, I mean, have Florence too.
This should be brought up at the meeting tomorrow night, Mary.
But I'm gonna let him know, because I can't be there tomorrow night, Drew and Alan, so. We have so many good business people up in Florence, that they'd be glad to put one up.
Oh, yeah, Rogers.
See this?
Yeah.
Yeah, the banks.
That Memorial Weekend is a real, we have to get guest speakers.
Well, you're getting that.
We have to get a guest speaker for Leeds.
I know, but who is the person that you're getting for the guest speaker, you told me for the Memorial Day?
Alan.
Alan Wine.
Wine.
Yeah, it's a new guy.
Yes, but I heard, well, good.
Steve brought him to the meeting.
Yes, exactly.
He's at the meeting.
Wow.
And I don't know the gentleman, I don't know.
Who's gonna sing?
Oh, Brian Joyce.
No.
No?
Veterans Day, he does. The girls from Florence.
Oh, why not?
Do you remember that question?
JF Keys.
JF.
We've tried to get the kids involved, and the Keys, they come to the breakfast, well, the kids get a free breakfast, but, you know.
And they sing.
And they will do Memorial Day in the cemetery, they've done it the last 2 years. I wish we could get the director of the high school band to play a different song than she's played for the last 10 years, different music.
Who's the director, Bill Flaherty?
No.
Oh, what's wrong with what she's playing?
Yes.
She's played the same music every single Memorial Day.
You could make a request.
Right.
Hey, you're lucky you got.
Give her a call.
Just call her now and give her time.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
They keep changing students, so them students don't see the same song all the time.
Come on, Ted, now.
Yeah?
You get call.
Oh, I'll get nailed.
You do a very good job.
I'm already, today has cost me enough aggravation already. It's my wife's birthday, and.
And you're here. It'll be an interesting evening.
Yes.
And you should have told Tom.
You'll be home on time for dinner, right?
If he had called me and told me this, I would have got someone else to fill in for.
Yeah, Tommy would have came.
Well, he's busy too.
Yeah.
Well, when you leave here, you can just go down the Elks and give your wife a call.
Pick up some flowers.
There you go.
There you go.
I already did that in the car, yeah.
All right, so.
Whereabouts in Israel did you go?
I do a whole tour. I have family up in the north, and I stay up there for a good portion of the time, and have people all over, so.
Yeah. I've been through the whole country from a lot
it's fascinating.
Up to the Lebanon border, and up to Mount Hermon.
Yep.
Oh, she has family. How many family members?
The kibbutz that I lived on for many years is right up in that little tip right by the Lebanese border. And it overlooks, you can look out and see the Hermon Mountain from there, so it's...
Oh, I know where you are. You're just below where the big winery is.
In the Golan, that's the Golan Heights. So we're between the Golan Heights, so that's the old Syrian border, and then the Lebanese border's there.
Yeah.
So we're right in between both of those places.
Yeah.
Did you go there?
Up to the water caves.
Yeah,
they're beautiful.
I'd love to see pictures of that.
Yeah. I liked a lot too.
You what?
I liked it down in a lot.
Oh yeah.
On the Red Sea, that was beautiful. And
did
the
you go there?
The
Red Sea's extraordinary.
Yeah.
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 You were there for work, Tim?
Off and on for over 4 years. I managed the guard construction teams over there doing work over there. I'd go over for 5 months and come home. Go over for 4 months and come home.
So. Remind your wife about that.
Right.
Tell her I'm here now.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, honey. Here I am.
Yeah. Well, the last 11 years I was in the service, I think I was home something like 18 months.
That's it?
11 years. I came home from the Nega for Christmas leave. And of course, it's 118, 120, right? I get off the plane.
The winter's cold there.
Not really. Not down.
We used to do our winter maneuvers down there.
Yes.
Anyway, and at night and tents, oh my God, it was freezing.
Yeah.
You know, the desert gets cold.
It gets cold at night, but it gets warmer in the day.
Yeah.
And always the sand blowing about 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh,
in the winter. It's
yeah.
Yeah, we'll talk sometime.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I have to bring some pictures.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
Did you ever go to Timna?
Yeah, I haven't been for years, but when I was a kid,
up the mushroom tree and mushroom rock.
Yeah. That's a beautiful place.
Yes, it is.
The silence there is just amazing. It's all red.
See, if we had a Japanese girl here now, I could talk about that.
Okay, I want to thank you, Brad. Thank you, Tim.
You're
and Rebecca
welcome.
For being here.
No problem.
And you're going to have to keep them too, just in case another event comes up. We'll have to bring you back in then, Brad, again with Steve, okay, because we have to do that.
We will get you the updates on dates and times.
But I would appreciate
but
that.
But I quickly put that together because we hadn't had the meeting and I wanted something to give you.
That's great. I appreciate that, yes. Thank you very much.
All right. We thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. And get home.
Happy birthday from us.
Oh, yes.
And get home because they're saying heavy winds and lightning.
It's boring. Thank you, Paul.
Bye, Tim. Going for supper Friday night?
What's that?
Are you going down the Oaks for supper Friday night?
I think that I'm going to, she wants to go to the grill over there, the old Glory Days.
Oh,
have you eaten over there?
No, but I've heard good things about it.
It's fantastic. It really is. It's good.
Really?
But Mary likes it over there, so that's probably where we'll go.
Tell her we said happy birthday.
Okay. Good night.
Good night.
Nice seeing you back.
Nice to see you.
Bye, Rebecca.
Bye.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to talk about the month of May. I was able to get 4:05 to 4:30 p.m. or so. ATP Gallery with Lisa Thompson.
APE, yep.
Whatever it is. APE. She's coming.
Great.
She's very nice. And I have Al coming in also. He'll be here at 5:45. I mean, 4:45, and to set up and so forth. He's gonna do a presentation on screen for NCTV.
Gonna need Pam for that, I suspect. But you'll be here on time to help us.
He will.
No, no, Al.
No more than me.
From NCTV, he'll do.
But he, like, people from the outside are allowed to do everything, turn, I mean.
He said, they are the, they are that.
Yeah.
Oh, of course.
Where are you at? That's okay.
I was thinking using the projector in whatever, it's like city property, so.
Yeah, no, you probably didn't associate the name with the.
No, 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 I knew, I just was thinking with the, with that. I mean, I know that they do, I don't know what I was thinking.
That is fine. But I saw Jeff Harness in our Commission on Disabilities yesterday, and the summit, you were not be able to attend that. I've talked with him, Peg Keller thought it was a great idea if we got him to come in.
All right.
So September, he's gonna come. I just wanted to give you a heads up on that.
Sounds good.
And one of the months, I'm not sure if it's June or July, I have the Young Hearts coming, who, their office is up in Florence, they're coming.
Wonderful. Do we not have a meeting in the month of August?
Right.
Is that what it is? So June and July we meet, but not August, okay.
Right, so I thought, right now in September, I got Jeff coming in.
Okay.
So if we can fill another. Also, I thought because at Cooley Dixon Hospital, they do have programs for people with psychological problems and so forth. Maybe look at that. I wanna get in brand new agencies. And Peg and I are trying to put our heads together. I mean, even if we reach out to like the Amherst area, I even thought of national priorities.
Mm-hmm.
That's huge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're a member of it. I am. And they do wonderful.
You know, another agency that might be another organization that's interesting is the CISA, the community
agriculture. Yes.
Sustainable agriculture.
CISA for
sustainable agriculture. Is
yes.
It sustainable?
Yes, because Jack Horner, remember he had him at his house with fundraiser last year,
yeah.
Or a year to that.
So that's an organization.
That's a good one.
Interesting.
I'll get them to come in.
And then that same day, it might be interesting, and I don't know if they're going to be able to do it in the summer because they're so busy, but the folks that put on the Tuesday market, that might be an interesting group to bring with CISA because they.
Do you know who they are?
Yeah.
Could you check that
they're,
out?
They're the people who own Town Farm. Over by Montview.
Can you find them?
I can ask them, yeah.
That would be super.
The people who do the farmer's market?
Yeah.
We have their name and phone number in the city clerk's office, too.
Yeah,
so.
I'm connected to them, so
yeah,
I
so please do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you can set them up, because if we get, what would you like
what
to do that?
What month are we looking at here? What months do we have available at this point?
Okay, June, forget that, because I have both Lehigh coming in, the Northampton Towns, and the Young at Heart on June 15th. So July, I have Deb Anthony coming from the Academy of Music.
Yep.
And I have the Center for Human Development coming in at 5 p.m. to Grace House.
Okay.
Okay, so. September.
It might be better for them just because the summer they're, you know, they're
right.
So busy.
All right, so we got Jeff. What time would you like to have? Do you want CISA and the other one coming in?
What month are we talking?
September? Or do you want in October?
October might be better and have both of them since it's both agriculture
okay.
Related.
I'll set it up with CISA or do you want to set it up with both? Or?
I can do both.
Thank you. Okay, that sounds like a good plan. And if you could think of somebody else for September, another agency, that would be cool. But I really would like to talk with Marilyn Richards about, there's so many programs going on at the Cooley Dickman. A lot of outreach. But I thought the summit would be excellent. I thought it was a good idea. Because right now I had Natasha come to the meeting with the Commission on Disabilities yesterday. And her and I are meeting on Friday. And we are going to be looking at, hopefully, to do a proclamation on sidewalks. The value of sidewalks, okay?
Why would you do that after we have a vibrant sidewalks?
No. This is about repair work and stuff like that. Oh, yeah, there's some great concerns going on with people. And it was brought up at our meeting on the Commission on Disability. Some of the sidewalks were not level. They want to come up like that, which has become very dangerous.
So a proclamation?
Or a resolution.
We included that in the Vibrant Sidewalks resolution. And I think creating a resolution is just not enough at this point. I wonder if there's something that would have a little more teeth that would actually create some mandates around that. Because the Vibrant Sidewalks resolution already has a clause that says, you know, they have to be passable and so forth, so create another.
We understand that, but there's really not that big authority right there to say to the Board of Public Works, you need to go out and look for grants, you need to go out and do this or do that, whatever, and get the money. Because the money is the big problem. Are we going to be looking at pilot programs to help us out? Because yesterday was brought out about all of King Street area of sidewalks. People, and even Tori Eklund, okay, she said, being legally blind, the sidewalks are not flat, they're up, and it makes it very difficult.
Yeah, I don't think a resolution is going to do anything.
What would you suggest?
I would start by talking to the mayor and talk about, it's a budgetary issue. I mean, it's extraordinarily expensive to go and, you know, fix every sidewalk in the city. I would start there and just talk about how can we prioritize this in the budget for the next year.
Right, I think I'll talk to Peter Kokot too. And Stan Rosenberg, it's not the first time, because I'm trying to do that, to get that money released from Boston to do the intersection of Florence Road and Ryan Road.
Right.
And we've been waiting 2 years now for that money.
Right.
And it was approved.
Right. So we're kind of off topic. Are we done with the meeting?
We are done.
So
all in favor?
You just called it? Okay, I'm in favor. I second it.
And I'm out of here.
Yes.